Okay, a little bit of an introduction, in fact, and a little bit of a correction, too, because when I was working on Serpent in the Sky, how I came about it, I wrote that somewhere. There go the prayer dudes.
Excuse me, Carlos, I'm just going to leave.
How would they like it if I did that? No, not at all. I interrupted their prayers. Actually, it's kind of cool. Some of these guys, some of them are really spectacularly gifted. And they won't go on long. If it's a Friday, they go on interminably. But this is just a couple of hours. And then, of course. Do it a little bit before because I got an important talk here to do. Don't interfere just because Allah wants me to get prayed to in that particular hour. So I was born, I think 1872 or one, in a scientific household. His father was a chemist, but he was very interested in these subjects and basically in the Hermetic doctrines. At a very early age, at 16, he wrote his first little treatise on Pythagorean number symbolism. And at a very early age, he was recognized as a sort of a prodigy. And was giving lectures to the Theosophical Society when he was 16 or 17. At what point he became a practicing alchemist, I'm not sure, but he was one. And when I was doing the book, by the way, even though I was working closely with his, he died in 63, I think. But I was working closely with his stepdaughter, but I still couldn't get really much interesting personal information about him. It's not that she was hiding it. It didn't seem much there. But recently, a book has come out, and if you're really interested, you can chase it through. It's called Fulcanelli and the Alchemical Revival. Fulcanelli is a pseudonym for a mysterious somebody who wrote an extraordinary book called The Mystery of the Cathedrals. And it was thought that it was Schwaller who wrote it. Turns out it wasn't really Schwaller, it was one of his pupils who stole his notes and published the book. Schwaller didn't even mind, apparently. But anyway, there was an alchemical revival in particularly in France around the turn of the 19th century, and a parallel one in England that had the Golden Dawn. But that wasn't specifically alchemical, that was more theosophical. Anyway, Schaller was schooled in all of those, as they're called, the Hermetic arts that started mainly in Alexandria around Greco-Roman times, when the Egyptian religion broke up, it took separate forms: alchemy, number symbolism, Neoplatonism, astrology, magic. All of those played a role in that, and these were the subjects, actually the favorite subjects of the great Renaissance scholars, who are always credited with starting modern science, which is true, but it wasn't what we call modern science. Probably horrified most of them. They were looking for, basically, they were looking for scientific, in the science of that day, scientific explanations for, basically, for their own religious beliefs. Most of them were deeply religious. Anyway, so there was this revival in Paris. And the author, by the way, anybody's interested, I may have it on my updated reading list, which is on my website. It's called Fulcanelli and the Alchemical Revival, and the author is Genevieve Dubois. Anyhow, so Schaller was, this is where I was wrong in the serpent, I didn't think he had come to Egypt specifically to look for the roots of the Hermetic doctrine, but it turns out that he was. That's what he's looking for. In 1937, he was very lucky. He had a rich wife, so he didn't have to have a day job, and could pursue his studies untroubled by mortgage payments. And in 37, they had a boat, and they came here, and he was looking specifically for the golden section and the associated Fibonacci numbers. Everybody know what the golden section is? Everyone, nobody doesn't know, okay. So I won't have to go into a palaver about that. And he reckoned, since this temple was built somewhere around 1350 BC, the Pythagoras, the great Greek mathematician, was always credited with having discovered the laws of harmony and the golden section. And Fibonacci numbers came later, according to the standard explanation. But Schaller came here because the Hermetic scholars and the Renaissance scholars as well, the sages of the Renaissance, were convinced that Egypt was the fount of the Hermetic doctrines that they were pursuing. And of course that was absolutely at odds with what contemporary scholars believed. So Schaller came here specifically to look for see if the Egyptians were using the golden section. If they did, that was enough to tell them that they understood all kinds of mathematical laws that they were not supposed to have understood. He was lucky because when he got here, and when he just started off, he with no particular plan, and starting to the north, and I don't know how long it took him to get down here, when exactly that was, but when he got here, walking through this, we've all been through it now, I mean, it's a pretty amazing and resonating place, but you wouldn't, of yourself, see it as a study in harmony and proportion, necessarily. It's built on these several axes, and it has a power, but I wouldn't certainly see it as a mathematically important place. But Schaller had basically what mystics call a revelation, and poets call an inspiration, and modern scientists call a hypothesis formation, in order to make it sound as boring and rational as possible. And Schaller's hypothesis formation was exactly that this was an exercise in harmony and proportion. He was very lucky because he settled down to look for that, but at the same time, the French Egyptological mission was here, measuring with surveyors, was surveying the temple, so he had measurements to work with down to the millimeter. And this is very important, because if you're doing these things, to be a foot off, that's no good. either it's precise or it's not precise. And if it's not precise, you can say, oh, well, it was just sort of luck. But when things are exact to the millimeter, you can be sure it's part of the plan. So that led him to the mathematics, the golden section, led him to a detailed study, and he was soon able to show that they were, that the Egyptians were embodying it in the temple in a manner far more sophisticated and complicated than the Greeks would later do in the Acropolis and the Parthenon and so on. And then once he got on to that, one thing led to another, and he found himself studying the astronomy and the medicine and the symbolism and really the entire Egyptian doctrine. He came here in 37. Well, by this time the Spanish Civil War was breaking out, and so he just stayed, and then along came Hitler. So it was a very good place. France was a very good place not to be. And so he stayed here through the war, putting together the symbolist doctrine, and in the end had reformulated. This is why, as I've said this before and I'll repeat it, in my view, it's the most important single work of scholarship in Western history, because it's a reformulation in terms that we can access with our advanced rational intellects, but without, for the most part, we've lost the sensibility to think in symbols. More on this when we get to Abydos tomorrow. And so he ended up writing this massive Temple of Man, the Temple of Ulam. And I told a little bit about how I came across it. I won't repeat it here. But anyway, so Schwaller basically, there had been others. I mean, even through the Renaissance, people working with the golden section and very knowledgeable hermetic people who explained the hermetic doctrines, who had a piece of it here and a piece of it there, but nobody really put it together with a kind of, with the scholarship that Schwaller put into it, with evidence that is actually irrefutable, and we'll be concentrating to a certain extent on that when we go through. So the reactions that I heard from people, I think everybody got a hit out of this, yes? I mean, this is an emotional experience. And the question arises to the contemporary mind, it's really just accidental, and really architecturally sophisticated primitives are responsible for this, but they don't really have any science. And so if it moves you, well, that's just your own romantic bent. It's not inherent in the temple itself. But in fact, when you understand what's involved, it is very inherent in the temple itself. Goethe, the German poet, once described architecture as frozen music, which is not just a lovely metaphor and poetically true, it's actually true, because music follows very specific harmonic and harmonic principles that are very, very specific. A note is a specific ratio. It all has to do with ratios and proportions. And the notes that make a symphony and that make a symphony work are what also employed in architecture, or what makes architecture work. These are resonating structures, and when you walk through it, you feel, at least I do, as though you're in the interior of a gigantic instrument. And it is what in music is sound vibration, here is visual vibration, but it is, in fact, all vibration. And once you understand that, you can see why the sacred actually works. I mean, without going into the metaphysics of, or the mathematics even, of why the sacred is the sacred, because of the way the numbers resonate with each other, the proof that it is so is actually quite formal. How many of you have heard of cymatics? Few. Okay. This is, okay, this is briefer on cymatics without, unfortunately, I mean, this is a much longer lecture, or should be a much longer lecture than I have time for. In the 1830s, there was a Swiss scientist, really, insofar as they had science in those days, who's called named Ernst Chladni, and what he was fascinated by the effects of frequency, and he did some little experiments. He fastened a metal plate to a violin and sprinkled sand on the plate, and then when he bowed the violin, the sand is of course all chaotic, when he bowed the violin at a certain frequency, the sand would form these beautiful mandala-like patterns, and then when he passed the frequency, it would all dissolve into chaos again, and he kept bowing, and at a harmonic of the frequency, it would form another beautiful pattern. And these were known as Chladni figures, and nobody paid much attention to them. They're sort of a curiosity of science. Then in the 50s or 60s, another Swiss named Hans Jenny, who was an artist and also a scientist, decided to do some experiments with the relationship between form and frequency. And so he built some rather simple devices that allowed him to vibrate different materials under strict control. And he found that depending on what he vibrated, powders and liquids spores, iron filings, all kinds of things like that, but under strict control. And he filmed this. And if you go online, he applied the name to it, cymatics or kymatics, which is the study of wave forms from the Greek, kymos, waves. And when you see it in film, the original film is rather primitive and very dry, the commentary very dry, because Jenny was going out of his way not to offend his colleagues, who would have been offended. But when you see it, it's something that really should be played in every high school twice a year, because what it shows you, it is actually a visual demonstration of the basis of practically every esoteric doctrine in the world, which is that the universe is a result of frequency. And this is now, all scientists would now agree with this, but in the legend, for example, in the Bible, it's in the beginning is the word. The word is a vibration. In French, they say la verbe, which means an active word. The Australian Bushmen, Aborigines, say that the universe was sung into existence by the spirits. In Egypt, Ptah, the architect of heaven and earth, creates the universe out of words spoken by Jehuti, who is the embodiment of cosmic wisdom. So there's this relationship between form and frequency. And when you watch this video, if you Google it up now, you'll find a lot of really interesting work that's been done along these lines, some of it getting really quite sophisticated. And what you're looking when you see it, and you see forms, backbones, and dragonflies, and nebula, and galaxies in front of your eyes, just forming out of the chaos of powder or metal or whatever, and then disappearing again as the frequencies are passed. It's really a powerful emotional experience. Well, this is why the sacred is sacred, actually, because if you know the laws, you can evoke certain responses in your audience. And when we talk about the gods of Egypt, I've mentioned this a few times, the gods should be recognized as cosmic principles. As soon as they're called gods, although it's polytheism and it's superstition. But when they recognize, science doesn't actually recognize principles. Everything is is evolution, and it's just an accident, you know, which becomes increasingly complex in form just by sheer accident. Not like that. And when you realize that you study the gods, or the gods are embodiments of cosmic principles, and they, they are associated for complicated reasons, but very demonstrative. They're associated with particular numbers and sets of numbers. Those numbers, in and of themselves, generate specific geometries, specific proportions, specific harmonies. When, you know, an enlightened architect, knowing the secrets of those numbers, employs them in a temple, the temple becomes the instrument that connects us as viewers or as participants within the temple rituals. I mean, we're not, we're visiting, but the Egyptian priests would have been participating in these very complex rituals. And effectively what's happening, because we vibrate, I mean, we're whatever it is, 70 or 80% water. So when we're walking through one of these stone symphonies, we vibrate when we listen to music, and we're accustomed to that. We take that for granted. But you tend not to think of a building as a structure as having that effect. But obviously it does, and it should, and it would. And it can't do otherwise, because it has its constituent harmonies or disharmonies. You walk into an ugly building, you know it. You walk into a McDonald's, it doesn't turn you on to anything other than maybe wanting a Big Mac, maybe. But anyway, this is the purpose of sacred architecture, actually. It wasn't somebody showing off, you know, or proving that they were greater than so-and-so, whatever. The purpose of sacred architecture is to connect you to the divine principle of which it is an expression. And it is a very powerful way to connect you. I mean, it works after thousands of years in ruins, and it's no longer our tradition. And we still, you can't really, you don't miss it. That's why we're here, to actually explore the various ways in which sacred architecture works. With Gurdjieff, some of you know Gurdjieff, a lot of you, some of you don't, but he always talks about certain kinds of influence. He has A influences, which are the influence of the outside world, and then there are what he calls B influences, which are these temples, which are expressions, sages, in order to make the participant or the visitor, whoever, cognizant of, let's say, that there is a higher purpose to our existence. And then the C influence is an actual school where you practice these things. So these are the B influences. This is what we're here for. And it's this, I hope you get a sense of this now, when I talk about, I may go on too much, and if I do, too bad, I don't care, of the difference between civilization and progress. This is civilization, and we'll see day after day after day after day as we go through, and it's the only, what's so interesting about Egypt, it's the only one of the ancient civilizations that has left us this kind of legacy. All of the others have more or less disappeared. You can't go spend 2 weeks, even in India, where there's a lot still standing, but it's not this old and it's not this grand, and you have to go all over the place to experience it. Gothic cathedrals are another instance of it. And just as powerful, but not as varied. So it's only in Egypt where we can actually go day to day to day to day to day, resonating to these unbelievable structures. So let's go through, let's wander through. I'll be pointing out certain instances of, I mean, mostly it's Schwaller's the salient, or the most salient elements within Schwaller's argument for the Temple of Man, which of course the academics do not accept, but one of these days, pretty soon, will happen.
Yeah, first, we are approaching the temple from the last part made in it. like this is the most recent part, and that's the part made by Ramses II, and John will explain how this relates to the man, the skeleton of the man. And then the original part inside is the older part, as we usually go. We proceed the temples from the newest, then we go in and in to the more old and more sacred even grounds.
Anyway, good, thanks, Isla, because of the fact that you mentioned this, there's a kind of a, particularly in the New Kingdom, there's a sort of a, the temples are very different from each other, and yet they follow the same general plan in that they're built in seven parts, actually. Seven is a number associated with process or growth. Most of them have what's called a pylon here, and what this is in stone a representation of really of the esoteric doctrine of the one becoming the many. And for example, there's a scene, we'll see it fairly often. It's a wave form, actually, because everything is a wave form. It's all vibration. And the Egyptians have a glyph that they call the Twin Peaks of Heaven. And it's a sine wave that goes like this. But in the middle of the soul is a solar disk. So it's the solar disk represents the one, the Twin Peaks of the horizon represent division, the two, what Shwala calls the primordial scission, the first act. We'll get into this in more depth as we go along. And what this is in stone, is that Twin Peaks of the horizon. This one is strange. Most of the temples are oriented east-west, so that at certain times of the year, they capture, they're tuned, or they're aligned to equinoxes and solstices. So at a certain day, few days really, the sun comes through that particular top part there. North, when they were oriented north-south, they don't, and there has to be a reason why it is oriented north-south, and I don't know why it is.
In relation to Karnak and to Habu, as the sacred geography suggested many times in many ways.
Well, Karnak is east-west, but why this one is north-south?
The natural side for...
There are lots of questions still to be answered. So let's go through. I'm going to time.
Where is the obelisk right now?
So the obelisks come, all granite, talked about this a bit, all granite comes from Aswan, which is a couple of hundred miles from here. These are cut, all of them are one piece of granite, different sizes. One of them is, I think this one is 300 and something tons. When we get to the so-called unfinished obelisk in Aswan, we'll have a good chance of sort of looking at the process in action, because the unfinished obelisk developed a crack in it and they couldn't continue to extract it from the bedrock. But then we get a really vivid idea of what's involved in extracting it from the bedrock, some of which we have a pretty good idea of, and a lot of it we don't have a pretty good idea of. It's an absolutely mind-boggling process. And in the 19th century, owning an obelisk was like having a space program. No self-respecting country didn't want an obelisk. And getting them, this is Victorian, already Victorian technology is already pretty good compared to, let's say, what they had in the 13th century. And there are interesting books, one of them by my friend, now deceased, Peter Tompkins, who wrote excellent books, still good, called Secrets of the Pyramid, Secrets of the Great Pyramid.
And the Magic of Obelisk.
And the Magic of Obelisk, which really tells it vividly that it strained Victorian technology to the absolute edge to try and get these things over and up. And this is with steam winches and all kinds of things like that.
How did they cool them down without breaking them?
I forget, but Peter goes into it. They somehow or another got them down. And
And also in the Renaissance, they had to figure out how to do it again. Because a lot of the obelisks in Rome were erected in the Renaissance.
Were they?
Yeah, the Renaissance. Yeah.
The Romans erected them.
Well, the Romans, they fell down. The Romans brought them over.
They fell down.
Yes. They were pushed over, and then they were buried, and then the popes pulled them back up.
That.
Yeah.
Really?
That's in Peter Tompkins' book.
They don't have that. Well, I forget, but
yeah.
They don't have, in Rome they don't have the really big ones. They don't have any of these massive ones. I'm not sure.
Rome, a couple are very big.
Two of them of Thutmose III, they are big.
They're big.
And the rest of them are small. They have 48. In
really?
Rome, 48.
Yeah. They have lots of them.
Yeah. Egyptian ones.
Yes. Oh, is there any Egyptian? You know, in Egypt, we don't have 40. We don't have 20.
No.
It's terrible.
No. Well, anyway, when I was working with, and I'll just tell you about it here while we're here. This is really important because taking the obelisks away is not a casual, it's a great engineering feat, but it's not just an aesthetic downside. When Lucy Lamy, when I was working with her, and she was in the south of France, and she had a theory, and she wanted me to go to the Egyptological libraries and see if I could get exact measurements. Somebody had taken exact measurements of the obelisks, and so I did that as best I could, and found that, she wrote back what she was suspecting was that the obelisks themselves were associated with the with the latitude of that particular temple. It would be an exact fraction, like a 1/500th of a degree or a 1/100,000, something like that. But not arbitrary. And then I realized, and I don't think she took it that far, but when we get to Karnak in a couple of days, there's a broken obelisk that's fallen on the ground and it's up on a plinth, and somebody showed it to me. I wouldn't have figured it out by myself. One of the early guides. Big chunk of stone, maybe 40, 50 tons. And if you stand at the end of the stone where the pointed end is, and you hit it with your fist, with the flat of your fist, it rings like a bell.
Oh,
you can hear it. So it's 50 tons of stone set into vibration from a soft blow. And I realized this, what they look like, if you see two of them, what does it look like? Exactly, it's a tuning fork. And so the earth, and so they're set up and they're tuned. If they're a specific fraction of the earth, they're actually tuned. And of course you're not gonna hear them, and nobody's gonna hit the top of the obelisk when it's, when it's standing up there at 100 feet in the air. But what it will be doing is it will be tuned to the Tellurian, the earth is not just a whirling piece of rock, it's full of all kinds of vibrations and different, magnetism and all kinds of things like that. So if the obelisks are literally tuning forks, it means, and the temple, when it's in operation, is not all open to the sky. The open courts are open, but really it is like a gigantic guitar, huge stone instrument. And so these would serve to, you wouldn't hear it, it would be subsonic, but you bet that the whole temple would be pulsating at a subaudible level. So removing one of the tuning forks is really, removing the Rosetta Stone doesn't make a bit of difference, but removing the obelisk makes a big difference, and you probably feel it even now. And this is what actually I never put it to Zahi when, as I said, we're in good personal terms now, and if he was still minister, I would tell him, Zahi, without quite saying it this way, your ego deserves a big thing. Why don't you get the obelisks back from England and France and all of these places? That would be a really interesting thing to do. But
do you have any idea why this one would have been taller on the side
no,
of the base?
No, it should be balanced.
No, some of them are different.
But paired, they are pairs.
But not necessarily.
But I mean, if you look at the base is different heights.
Yep, that's true. That's
well, you're going to notice this in other occasions as well.
But you know, in Rome, they're always put in front of Christian churches.
Yeah.
And when I was there, I couldn't understand that. And now, from what you're saying, that makes perfect sense.
Mm-hmm. Why?
Because
it has something.
Because it resonates.
It resonates.
Yeah. They see the it's strange. I mean, our Church of Progress has obliterated a lot of understanding that was still there not that very long ago. I mean, the science of acoustics, the Cistercians, geniuses at building incredible abbeys that really have this resonance. And they knew what they were doing, and it's kind of got lost. It's being rediscovered now. You know, there are enough people around that if we had the money and the will, we could be building sacred structures again. It wouldn't be these.
We have an hour.
Yeah, okay.
And the owl is here.
Well, we don't care. Everybody will come back and we'll do it.
The owl, the white owl is back here, John.
A curious thing. This is built by Ramses the Great. And as you notice, there's a sharp, the axis is skewed. This was a big problem when they were excavating in the 19th century. They were arguing about what was responsible for this strange skewed axis. Some of them thought, well, it was a bend in the Nile, and they sort of conformed to the bend in the Nile. Lockyer, the British astronomer, who was the first one, as far as we know, to hypothesize that Stonehenge was an astronomical instrument for which he earned the derision of his colleagues, though he happened to have been right, thought that it had something to do with the star alignment, but he was not able to prove that. Could have, but it didn't seem to check out. But Schwaller, I think, solved it. Do all of you have the serpent? Are you all familiar with the drawing that Schwaller did of the the skeleton superimposed of the temple superimposed upon the skeleton? And I'm not sure if I have both of them in the serpent, but the skeleton one way, in other words, if he just goes from the one end to the other, it fits exactly to the measure of the, like Osiris, exactly to the measure of the male, average male skeleton. But if you turn the skeleton around so it's in profile and it's in action, then you see, like all of this part, according to the plan, if this thing really is meant to represent actually and symbolically the ideal or the average male skeleton. Women have different proportions, so this is the temple of man, not the temple of all humanity, because there's a difference, as some of us have noticed. And Schwaller noted that if the skeleton is top to bottom, it perfectly matches the end of the temple. But if you take one of these striding colossal figures as the other way the skeleton is measured, then this foot is exactly goes to where the temple ends. And in other words, the axis is created in order to set the temple
in movement,
yeah. And this is a very powerful evidence, because it's here that you see all of these striding colossal figures of the pharaoh, and nowhere else you see lots of striding colossal figures, but nowhere, to the best of my knowledge, is there a whole room of that. And here, I mean, this is what is the lower leg for? The lower leg is moving into action, and when you walk in here, Even if you don't notice it, when I point it out to you, you'll notice it easily. But even so, just walking in here, your eye goes right to the center of the shin of these striding colossal figures. So this is where the motion starts. So this is, as far as I'm concerned, a really powerful piece of evidence. Now over here, when the Egyptologists and the excavators came through in the in the middle of the 19th century and started digging out the temple, they obviously, this little mosque over here, this pretty little mosque, was in the way. And there we go. See over there where the dancing red light is? That was where the sand came up through the blown in sand. So that's why the mosque is up there. And in front of it there was a Roman, the Romans put that part up, and the Roman church. And when they were excavating, there was a big fight going on because the local people, that's a particularly revered holy man, very early 12th Islamic, Muslim 12th, 13th century, done in several stages. And the archaeologists wanted to take the mosque down and restore the temple to its original look. And the townspeople said, well, we don't care about the temple, that's our mosque. And they won, so good. I mean, actually, as far as I'm concerned. And strangely enough, certain of the rituals involved in the temple got carried on even down through the centuries, because the next place we'll go, and you hardly see any of it now because the reliefs are so obliterated. But there's a gigantic festival that went on once a year. I'll talk more about it there, where the boats come from Karnak with the statue of the god, and all of these celebrations are carried out. And in fact, it's in the summer when this is the Egyptian New Year, when the flood rises. And there's still to this day a festival for the holy man whose mosque this is, Abu el Haggag, in which more or less they do the same thing, but they don't realize that they're repeating a ritual that was going on in Egypt 1500 BC. Anyway, so it's interesting that it's there, and that tells you how high the sand was. By the way, anybody who really gets bitten by the Egypt bug, when Napoleon came through in 1802, I think it was, he came with all of his scholars and artists in order to, he was a mason, right? He had a number of scientific projects to map the circumference of the earth and a whole bunch of other things. But really, he was also looking for to see if he could find the roots of the Masonic doctrine in Egypt. And I don't think he found them, but they're here. I'm pretty sure that the masonry derives, probably indirectly, what goes back, is traceable back to Egypt. But anyway, they did these wonderful steel engravings in this massive book, 22 volumes, called the Description d'Egypte, the Description of Egypt. And they reproduce that now in varying, in some big expensive volumes, but some nice tidy little thick volumes, but it's all there. So anyone bitten by the bug, it's interesting to see, because a lot of stuff that was still there when Napoleon went through is not there now. Things got cannibalized and ripped down, things of that sort, but well worth in the good bookstore, which we will be a couple of times, particularly in a really good bookstore where the fallen obelisk is. It's well worth having that nice big fat little book. So anyway,
John,
yes,
are these stones on top up here, are these single stones, or are those little stones they put together and then carved on the outside? Or
oh no, those are all, you can see where the joints are.
Yeah, I didn't know there was
those are lintels. Oh yeah, no, they're big chunks of stone. We'll get into
these. Are even bigger.
Oh yeah, look. Oh yeah, well, but look at what we saw with the Sphinx.
Yeah.
I mean, these are building blocks compared to what those things that we saw at the Sphinx. Yeah. So yeah. Now let's see. I'm forgetting something. Where's the highlight? Anyway, so this is setting the temple into motion, and Anyway, let's move on. In the front, in the pylon, you had this colossal... You had the two seated colossal figures, and then the two obelisks, and then there were four other, only two of the remaining, of standing colossal statues of the king. And then these strange windows up at the top where there's a deep groove. You notice that? Well, nobody knew exactly what those grooves were for in the windows that the cut through. And then they found, as they were excavating, they found this... as far as anyone knows, this unique plan of the temple itself. It's, you know, shown here. You see the facade. You see the pylon here. Okay, so you see the pylon, and here are the seated figures, not shown in profile, not facing as they would be, and here are the two standing colossal figures, and here you have this long. Here's the obelisk. And then you have these long flagpoles with banners flying from them. And actually, they don't show it, but here are the windows that cut through. So the look of this thing, is apart from it's all being in color, but they have these huge flagpoles with banners, everything in color. And because of the windows there, the cut openings, there's a cross draft going through, so the whole thing is continually fluttering. It's just a neat little attention to detail. They went to a lot of trouble to put those to construct this with those long niches and then the flagpoles and so on. I mean, it's not just a casual thing of let's put a flag up there and have it waving. Anyway, so this is unique. I don't know of any other temple that has this. And over here are the sons of Ramses, who lived very old into his 90s and had, I believe it's 66 wives and 192 children. And the ones in the front here are the ones from his royal queen, and then the others are lesser princes. But anyway, 192 children. And that's why in America we named the condom after him. So let's go wandering around. So yes, remember we were in the museum yesterday. I was talking about the wonderful the Khafra statue, and it has the scene of tying up in Lower Egypt. But here's a particularly brilliant one, and. This is Ramses. It's his colossal figure. And some very interesting things here, and here you can do it in detail, and nobody's going to tell me to turn that away this morning. I think I need a new battery in there. Anyway, so this is the union of Upper and Lower Egypt, which even the academics are now getting to realize is not... a truce between warring parts of the country, but rather symbolically represents the material world of the north and the spiritual world of the south. And here you see the lotus flowers of the south, these are the papyrus flowers of the north, and this is the Nile shown as a trachea and lungs. So the Nile is, even though it's water, it's recognized as the breath of Egypt, which is, you know, perfectly appropriate symbolically. And you see that they're tying it together, and every little bit of this has some sort of significance, a lot of which I don't know enough detail to be able to expound upon it, which is just as well because we only have that much time to spend in the temple. But some very interesting lessons here. You see Hapi the Nile himself, shown as a sort of as an old man, androgynous, with a pendulous woman's dress, and a pot belly. He's old man and old woman river simultaneously. And here, this is his name up here. Is his throne name is Usur, that's the jackal-headed staff, and that's Maat, who represents cosmic equilibrium or justice or law, and that's Ra,
which is often shown that way, as a solar disk, as a disk with a little nib in the center, with something, I mean, it's meant to be, even though it's the sun, it's meant to represent the breast, you know, a nipple of a breast. And or the point, both the circle of eternity and the point that you put the compass on to create the circle. And so there's Ramesses' name, Usermat Ra Seteben Ra. But it's not in a cartouche, which is what you would normally expect. Now, you turn around and you see the other side here. There, you see up the top there? There's the cartouche. Cartouche is a French word that simply means cartridge, a musket cartridge. The French soldiers, that's what it looked like, and it's been called a cartouche ever since. What it actually is, we don't see it here, but we will see lots of it. There's a symbol in Egypt. It's a perfect circle, a ring, with a bar underneath it that's tied to the ring. It's called the Shen Ring of Eternity. Exactly why it takes that shape, I'm not 100% sure. But in order to, they used it from the very earliest times to enclose the name of the pharaoh. And in order to do that, here it is up here, there's the cartouche. I mean, in other words, you can't, if it's just a circle, it's rather difficult to put a whole long name in it. So they extended it to give that cartouche form. And what's being symbolized there is that the king's name, it's the Shen Ring of Eternity, and what's being symbolized there is that the king's name, he's realized. In other words, his Sky unites with Ba, what we were talking about at the solar boat. And his identity is immortal. In other words, his name lives forever. And that, I don't know how many of you guys went to the, or got cartouches at Radwan or not, but there's something about that shape that people find attractive, and maybe they all want, we all want our name to live forever without actually doing anything about it. So, but anyway, that's what that symbolizes. But what's peculiar here is that, see, the names of the gods do not have a cartouche. They're immortal to begin with, I suppose, and they don't have to work for it. But so here's Ramesses' name, Usermat Ra, and over here it is again, but inside the cartouche. Now, what's peculiar about this, comes from Luxor, and we have a big discussion about this, because generally speaking, the western bank of the Nile is where the burials and all that take place. The Egyptologists say, well, you know, that's the land of death. No, it's actually not the land of death. It's the land of transformation and accomplishment. Big difference. And the east, of course, is the sunrise and the land of beginning. So here you have the king on the western. Here he is. The king is actually shown here. The king is a god. He's a god, no cartouche. And on this one, there's the cartouche, but that's facing east. So what we figured out, Emil and I, is actually that though this is the western colossus, it's facing east. And this is the eastern colossus, and it's facing west. So they're playing a trick, a little bit of a trick with right brain, left brain, optical nerves crossing, that sort of thing, because they could easily have done it the other way around. But for reasons of their own, they do it that way, not the other way. So, very interesting. When you look at this closely, you see, and I don't know why exactly, why, but you see that the figures are a little bit different. There are different numbers of papyrus stalks, different numbers of lotus stalks. There's a reason for every single one of these things. And for somebody, an ambitious young scholar, to go into the details of these things and figure out why each little detail is what it is, because there is some good reason.
Does anybody have a flashlight?
Hey,
John, I wish to... No, that's blue.
You need a bite?
I got one of my
own. That's good. Come 1 second, please. See this one before we get to move back. Look at this wonderful lady. Sishatia John, she's in her best here. Huh? With her very special flower over her head. and John will tell you about that flower. And she's the consort. Yes, it's a marijuana. And she's the consort of Jehuti. And she has the pen writing on the palm frond, you know, like it's also a symbol of immortality. And the shin ring that John told you about is right in the bottom, with a tadpole. But look at also her dress and how she is. So it's a beautiful sishat in the back here. With this ends Ramses II part. We're going to the older section and the original part.
A little bit, but they're not actually. This part here. I mean, even when it's lit up, it's hard to follow it. But there's a huge procession that takes place here. This, by the way, this is Amon. When the new kingdom starts, actually when the middle kingdom starts, the focus of religion shifts from the north, where it's centered in what's now Heliopolis and Memphis, which is, let's say, consecrated to the great creator gods, Ptah, the architect of heaven and earth, and Ra or Ra-Atum, who's the primordial solar principle, initiating principle. When it gets down here, and I'm pretty sure that there's a sequence, of absolutely deliberate sequence to this. Schwaller, by the way, contended that even the Pharaoh was an absolute ruler, but he didn't just whimsically say, well, I'm going to build a temple to so-and-so here and another temple to somebody else here. According to Schwaller, the Pharaoh himself was both initiated by and instructed by what he calls the temple, a corpus of initiated priests who actually determined what was to be built and why and when and how. And anyway, when the Middle Kingdom comes along, the religion, the focus shifts from Ptah and Ra to Amon, whose name means hidden. Amon is his name, and sometimes he's shown in a covered shrine so that you can't see him. But what he represents, actually, Genesis, the book of Genesis is actually a truncated cosmology. It's actually, there's a lot of science in it. And what Amun represents in biblical terms is the breath of life across the water. He's the principle that animates the universe itself. So here, these temples, almost all of these New Kingdom temples, are consecrated to Amon in one of his many diverse forms. And in here, in this particular part of the temple, which corresponds to the femur, the upper leg, and it's decorated actually by Tutankhamun, one of the few things left by Tutankhamun. And here, Amon's consort, the goddess, his female counterpart, is Mut, maybe the root of the word mother, possibly. And here it's with the face of Tutankhamun, who was just commenting on the Asian look of this. Who was saying that? Someone was talking about it looking Asian. And but it is the face of Tutankhamun. I don't know, Sahila, we can't. Is there any point going back there? Okay. Oh well, okay, let's you can't see it.
Maybe
anyway.
We can do things if we have extra moments.
Yeah, let's
do you. John told you this wall is one of the fewest that Tutankhamun carved. And on this wall and the opposite wall, there is the the Opet festival was represented. Opet is celebrated in the height of the river in June, July, and August. They did this mid-July. And it's a huge thing, a national thing that was so strong. It is when Amon-Ra would leave his home in Karnak, carried in the sacred boat, put in the larger boat, sail, pushed to here in the river, where he spends 10 days with his second wife in the sanctuary and then returns. So this is the coming and that's the return trip. All the reliefs here in very lovely Amarna style of Akhenaten, the realized natural one, show the trip of Amun-Ra coming and the celebration and the towing, and they are falling on their knees in adoration. Amun-Ra is in the presence, because you can't even have a glimpse of Amun-Ra or come closer to the statue all year round, except when he leaves the temple. So he's around in the river somehow, and people crowd in to see it, you know, and many parades. This whole trip ends here. See the River Nile? Look, that's the river. John had the pointer. Huh? So this is the River Nile. You see? It's that.
It's,
yeah, okay. Here is the river. And see the, over here you see the soldiers with the shields, like an entourage to the procession of Amun-Ra. And it ends here. Look at that's the end of the river and the trip. Where in here you see the beginning of the temple. So that's the celebration. They are sacrificing the huge bulls. Look at them, cutting them into pieces. And look at the leg. They are making a lot of sacrifice in here. Huh? See, I like this guy who's saying some word to his colleague, and he's hiding his mouth while talking, and this one is listening and following what the other guy is telling. So there is, look at this guy pouring some liquid, and this one is doing the incense to the food. Look at the leg again, and the women, the girls are flipping back and doing dances and the drum player, and then in the end you have a huge banquet.
Yeah,
banquet. Feast with birds and grapes and pomegranates and dates. All the beauty and the food displayed as offering in the end of this.
An interesting thing about this is that two things. One, have anybody read Graham Hancock's first book called Sign and the Seal?
Yeah,
very interesting book, where he's tracing the Ark of the Covenant to Ethiopia, where it may actually be, we don't know. But one of the interesting things about it is that the Ethiopians, one of the pieces of, let's say, what do you call it, evidence that's not hard evidence, but what do you call it?
Circumstantial
evidence, thank you. That says there's something to the whole idea, is that the Ethiopians celebrate in the summer their holiest of festivals, which is called Tikmat. It's a strange sort of semi-Christian religion, a very strange religion that they have there. But it's almost identical in the way that it works to this Egyptian festival of Opet. And, you know, it's hard to independently come up with exactly the same festival. Now, another really interesting bit about this is that it is, according to the plan, it's the femur that that's being celebrated. And this is where you would think, I mean, sort of logically, that it would be the lower leg setting into motion that would be representing a procession and this kind of a trip. But Schwaller, who is really into heraldry, deduced, and I think correctly, is pretty brilliant, that the femur is chosen as a place where, let's say, the harvest is celebrated, because it's in the femur that the majority of the red blood corpuscles are formed in the human body. And apparently, according to Schwaller, I'm sure it's true, one of the aristocratic families of France, it might be Orléans, their heralded sign, you know, usually it's a lion or it's this, that, or whatever, is crossed femurs, which again comes down to us in the Jolly Roger in one sense or another. But that's, I thought, a particularly, to figure that out, why it's the femur, where they're having this tremendous procession, is pretty brilliant.
Yeah, it's the factory of the blood.
Right. All good terminology.
Yeah, it's where the whole oxygen and blood is made and food, yeah?
Blocking the sewage from going out into the river, which was then coming up underneath and effloresing the reliefs and stuff like that. Big damage done, but most of it was, not much of it was actually been reconstructed. But there's a really interesting bit here. Actually, no matter what I do, I run out of time here, because there's a lot of story here to tell, and I can only tell a little bit of it. And at one point, when Scala was working here, and had the idea that this was the Temple of Man, that was not absolutely obvious to him, that it was harmony and proportion, yes, but that it represented the human body, the male skeleton, that came later. And he was not convinced himself that this was the case, and he needed some proof. And he didn't have the hieroglyphs. His wife had subsequently become fluent in the hieroglyphs, but when they were just starting to work, she didn't. And there was one young Egyptologist, very promising, bright young guy, who was, of course, as an Egyptologist, they part of being an Egyptologist, you can read the hieroglyphs. And Schwaller felt that if there was anything to this theory, this represents the midsection here. And if the colossal figure is turned on its side, so it's in profile, so that it's facing the east, you could face it the other way too, but for whatever reason, I'm not sure how he determined that it works when it's facing east and not the other way around. There was one of the architraves up
temple,
here.
So it has to face east.
So facing east, probably.
Yeah, for the mortuary is different.
Yes, probably. Mm. And anyway, there was right in the center, if this really represented the male skeleton, human body, there was one particular architrave there that would have represented, it would have been right where the navel is. And there are inscriptions up there, but Schwaller couldn't read them, and so he asked Alexandre Viril, was his name, to translate it for him. And Viril could read it off as if it were the newspaper. And Sahila, what is it again? I never
it's
remember
it
exactly.
It's the only architrave in this whole temple that has this one sentence. It's not repeated. And it's exactly where they thought there should be something in this or this architrave.
Right, and good.
And it is like, in hieroglyphic it says this is where life starts and develops, and the king kicks out and goes to life and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, and follows his destiny, a word
it's
for
in
that
the,
effect.
It's in the guidebook.
Yeah, I have it in the guidebook. I always forget it myself. But anyway, that was, as far as Schwaller was concerned, that was the proof that he needed to keep going and to pursue his studies. And so he did. That's
he's
why
genius.
You guys are all here. Brilliant. Anyhow, other interesting things here, when we go to the Luxor Museum, some back in the 80s, they were cleaning stuff up around here. And where is it there?
Exactly here. In this spot. Exactly this spot.
Anyway, they were cleaning things up.
They
took away a couple of slabs, and because the water was coming up, surfacing the, up
this
from
is
underneath.
Not the original
this
slab.
This is not the original floor, actually, yeah. And anyway, they were cleaning things up, and all of a sudden, a stone arm sort of surfaced up through the mud. Big news. And they, they set about excavating it, and they found a cache of, how many, 26, I think,
about,
statues?
About.
So 20-some-odd statues that have been hidden away, probably similar to hiding the copper statue in the Valley Temple, because the Persians or the Syrians were invading, and they wanted to preserve the most sacred of their statues, because they were they were destroying lots of them, so they hid them there. And so this was one of the great finds of all Egyptology. And these statues, they went from around the time that the temple was built down to, I think, Ptolemaic, or no, not Ptolemaic,
it's
no,
only
later,
the,
late
the
kingdom
new, the,
or something,
the,
mostly New Kingdom.
Yes.
But some of them, there are a few of them that are really unparalleled and perfect condition and absolutely fabulous works of art. You sing when we go. You can't talk when you're in there. You can't lecture, actually. And just as well, when we go to the museum, I'll just direct you there, and then you tell me what you get from which statues, because these are absolutely incredible
things. I have to tell you that when you come to this very court, you feel a powerful feeling with the lights on the columns here. These are considered the most elegant and the best example of columns that are so realized in detail to represent the shut or the closed buds of, is this set?
And this is papyrus.
Papyrus, yeah. And that represents the open, but open. Most of them are broken.
All columns.
Open, but these are, you see the bundles? They have dried the bundles and they rolled them up. That's what they represent, the organic life.
But originally they would have been organic here. Forms
and
using
the same
using bumble.
The oars on the boat, the solar boat.
Yeah. Okay. Oh yeah. Well, that's
something
different.
Else.
That's
you
different.
Sure
we'll
you.
See when we get the kayak.
Yeah.
And then everyone anyway. Look straight up. You've got the only constellation that looks like a man, Orion.
Oh.
Straight ahead this time of year. Kind of
very reasonable.
I can't see.
You can't
my
see.
What did you
say?
No, my eyes are not that good.
I have a
what did
flashlight.
You say about organic materials on the columns?
Well, the columns are representing in the early before they were building in stone, they were making columns out of bundles of papyrus stalks. And in Egypt, we'll see this is interesting because all columns up till Ptolemaic, when they get more complicated, are either lotus or papyrus plants, but either in bud or in flower, and it has to be some sort of fairly obvious reason why one is one and the other is the other, but that's what they are, with one exception, and that's a Hathor column, and you'll see that talk about that tomorrow. A column of Hathor, the goddess Hathor, who is the cosmic feminine. What?
Is it in Dendera?
In Dendera, yeah, but elsewhere as well. Most, it doesn't look like much, but it is, in my view, one of the most compelling pieces of evidence that the Temple of Man really is the Temple of Man and represents exactly what Rolla says it represents. But here, this is a hypostyle hall. Hypostyle hall means just covered hall. All New Kingdom temples, and later on too, have hypostyle halls. And symbolically, every hypostyle hall represents, symbolizes the part of the Osiris, Isis, Horus myth where Horus has been dismembered by Osiris has been dismembered by his what am I thinking of? It's also Moses in the papyrus, Moses in the bulrushes is a variant of the same story. But anyway, here, because it's the Temple of Man, and here, remember we saw the union of Upper and Lower Egypt, of the Nile itself as a set of lungs. So here, and the lungs are always associated with, even though the Nile is water, the lungs are associated with breath, of course, and by another association with the moon. So here in this particular hypostyle hall, only in this one, you have the phases of the moon cut into the bases of the column. You see, it's over at the very at the end there. There's nothing. It's just a new moon. And the next one is a crescent moon.
And
then
this
one is a bigger moon. And the one at the outside is as much as you could still do a full moon and keep it integral to the base of the column.
Oh.
Almost certainly, this is not the original floor. Oh. Almost certainly, I would be willing to bet that that was inlaid with silver when it was. It was a mosaic. This is the hall that would have represented the heart, and it had columns here. It was called the Heart of Eight, Hall of Eight Columns. I'm not exactly sure why, but it was taken over in Roman times and reconsecrated as a temple. And actually, it's strange. We'll see lots of this as we go through the early church when it Christianized. Did not wreck stuff, as you know, as they were wont to do later on, but rather appropriated particular sacred parts of the temple, cut in their own Coptic cross, sometimes Byzantine cross, and it served them as their own church. So in other words, there wasn't this subsequent bitter conflict that there has been for the last, anyway, since the Crusades. Anyway, this is the heart, and over there, well, you can't really see it that well. They plastered it over, and you see over there at the top, you see it's painted, and you see sort of pictures of the saints with their in there.
Look here, and in the niche, they added also this niche.
And they added that horrible Roman niche.
Because there was an altar here. Huh. This was a Roman church.
Yeah.
They took heart for the church.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So they took a particular, it wasn't just anywhere that they took. They took the heart. Yeah, they knew what they were doing. Yeah.
Why is that foot upside down?
Because the when they're reconstructing, when the Romans are reconstructing, they don't care, and they're just recycling the blocks, and they don't care, and they're going to plaster over
Actually,
it anyway.
There also were. We used to see columns. Yeah. They cut off the columns. They now cover it with this. But there used to be the circles where the columns were filled up here. So they cut off the columns and put those two partitions to do a church.
This horrible arch.
John, let's go to the important room.
Yeah.
So and David can go to this. And then we can do the work.
Right. Now, everybody here?
Yes.
This is another really major piece of evidence from a variety of points of view. This is the hall that, on the plan, represents is at the place of the vocal cords, and it's here over the doorways there, where the various names of the king are written. But more important, over here you have a scene here, which Charlotte calls the theogamy, the marriage of the gods. And here you have, this is Amon, always has this twin, they always say it's a plumed headdress, but it doesn't look like a plume to me. I don't know what it represents. Incidentally, you always see the different gods and goddesses wearing these variety of crowns and headdresses. No one has ever found a material representation ever of any of those crowns. They represent somehow the consciousness of the particular principle. I'm ballparking it, but I can't go much more than that. Anyway, this is the mother of Amenhotep III, the queen mother. His name is Mutamuya. And here is, she's got her, you see, she's sitting opposite the god himself, Amon. And you see that their hands are interlaced, and they're sitting on a bench, which is itself being supported by two goddesses, which are Neith and Selket, the scorpion, the goddess of the scorpion and the weaving shuttle that we saw on the where they had the canopic jars in the museum. And anyway, and they're sitting on a bench, and this is actually a bench, but it's a hieroglyph, which means heaven or the celestial sphere. And in this long, in the long text here, what the god is telling the queen is that she is soon going to give birth to a divine child. So what does that sound like, all you Catholics in here? Right? It's the Annunciation in 1350 BC. So, and it's very, it's formal, there's no arguments about that. So it is actually the Annunciation, and there's another representation of it in Hatshepsut's temple, but not as clearly shown as here. So really, the segue, the church is actually very much against this. They want to think that they invented all of it. My own conviction is that if the Christian churches in whatever denomination are going to survive the wrath to come, it will be, if they don't recognize that they're simply another stage in a process that was going on long before they came into existence, they're just going to go down with the ship. And if they do recognize it, they might take on a new life. If they can just pull the priests off the choir boys, which remains to be seen.
I'd like to show you a couple of important things here. First, you see that, where is that? Amun Ra, he's telling Khnum, the ram-headed god, to create, he's the creator god.
On a potter's wheel, by the way.
He makes gods and babies. So look at him, see in the back seat, here he is, I'm pointing. He's fashioning two babies, one, and maybe that's the car. So he's making the babies. Now, Jehuti up, right up. Jehuti, cosmic wisdom. Look at him, he's addressing the queen. Look at her, his hand up. You are going to carry the child of God. So the next scene, look at her, she's in normal size. She has bigger stomach, see? she became pregnant. Yeah. Actually, she's been taken by assistant Hathor deities, our goddesses. Look at them, taking her to the maternity bed. See the maternity beds? Where she, right here, is giving a child on a child stool.
Birth stool.
So she gives the birth, where there are two assistant Hathors as well. She's always, look at the teeth. John showed you this teeth with the towered before. It's always in maternity. Anyway, child is born. Look at, the child will be born. Look at the child given to, gods, and he'll be raised as a god and blah, blah, and education.
Who is the child?
Mashi, let's go to the sanctuary.
Well, in this case, it's Amenhotep III.
Yes, yes.
But symbolically, mythically, it's Horus, king.
Oh, yes. Let's go to the sanctuary in the back room, please. And watch your step.
Maybe go to...
No, I should take you a second.
Oh, okay, great.
You guys can move on. I'll just
do it.
What's the big deal about this?
This is an Annunciation.
But I mean,
so it's the voice.
When you hear something physically in here that you know?
You know what I think? Maybe you should do it in the sanctuary because it has resonating quality.
Okay, but this is the symbol of sound.
Yeah?
Okay. Symbolically, this is where the sound comes from.
Yeah. Let's do two.
So,
David, don't be shy. I mean, because we're not thinking of your...
Sure, I just don't see what this one would do, but who knows? I don't know.
See, because it's got cover on it, it's got a roof that's not natural.
Yeah.
But it had. It was roofed originally.
Yeah, with different resonance.
Yeah.
It's a powerful place regardless.
Yeah.
Let's just see what happens.
All right, let's see what happens.
Let's test it, how this works. Wow.
Are you imagining?
Yeah, it's
so
really
let's
flat.
Go to the
it's like, this would be a great place to do a recording.
David, where's your bed?
To do a recording. But
maybe the resonating spot can do something.
Okay. Imagine that room. If I had that room with both of you, I would be fine. It's
perfectly flat. Run some classes here.
Try here.
Try this one. Because this is the sanctuary.
Yeah.
the so-called Holy of Holies.
We need to get out.
You hear how... Actually, it would be best if you guys were out, because then I wouldn't have you guys
walking right. off. All right. Well, let's go to the back. We're going to the back.
If you just hear right here, you don't hear the echo. It's really flat sounding.
Yeah, really flat. But let's go to the back.
So this part of the was sacred in ancient Egyptian, the shtiyat, and the word for the passages is the same word, shtiyat. And according to Schwaller, it's because when you're doing a chant, when you're doing an om, you're doing it properly. You're vibrating those sinus passages, and that's why he says that it's here in this particular temple. That's what it represents. In other temples, it wouldn't represent that. But it's from the sanctuary that the entire temple grows. Actually, it's a seed. The sanctuary is seen as a seed. And it's usually what they build first. When Alexander comes in, he's replacing, he's taking over from the Persians, and is actually welcomed by the Egyptians as a savior. And he travels all the way out. There's an oracle, almost by Libya, called the Oracle of Siwa, where it was particularly sacred in those days. And he traveled all the way out there. Now there's a road, and it's still a tough way to go, but it used to take weeks of camel to get out in the trackless desert to get to Siwa. And Alexander went out there to confer, to see what the priests had to say about his right to rule. In other words, was he really of divine birth? And the priests, I think for reasons of their own, said that he was. And he came back and took over as ruler of Egypt and started the Ptolemaic, the dynasties, all the way to the end of Egypt. Let's go quick. It can't be helped.
David! David!
What?
I feel like we've been here an hour.
Yeah, I know.
David, I suggest you go to this room in the back and try to imagine.
Well, see,
the
roof isn't on, but let me go. I want to go quickly here.
Yeah, sure.
This represents the optical nerves where they cross, and right brain, left brain, and all of that. But the even more interesting is the symbolism on the walls and things like that corroborates that. But this little three triple shrine at the very end. That's really the interesting one from my point of view, because I have this in both the guidebook and the serpent. If you, a geometric analysis of those three shrines, which according to Schwaller, represent the three higher centers. And it's quite simple, and it's a play of geometry, making use of the golden section and the square root of three, I think. But it's simple enough, you could say, with a ruler and a compass, you might come up with such a thing just because it looks rather nice and, without taking any deeper significance to it. But Schwaller was, measuring everything to millimeters, noted that the center little hall here, the center little chapel, looks square, but actually it isn't. It's exactly a proportion of 8 to 9. And 8 to 9 is, anyone who are our musicians here, is the
David
first
is.
Note. You pluck a monochord at 8 ninths, and that's your first note, do, re. So in other words, at the very bottom, the very end of the temple, it is the proportion that sets the whole musical temple resonating. So in that, you can't come up with 8 to 9 by accident. So
yeah.
This is one of the more
and this part,
most powerful pieces of evidence.
The very top, the crown, is cut off. For it's the ego.
Yeah, according to Schwaller, it's deliberately cut off. It's very complicated. Again, it's a grid of 18 19ths. It's a 19 squid grid in which the whole temple is realized in 18, and the 19 isn't accounted for. And according to Schwaller, it's because that's the part of the brain where the ego resides, and this is consecrated to what Schwaller calls Adamic man. In other words, man before the fall. And interestingly enough, he backs this up with a French, I'm not sure if it's not an icon, but a French painting of a particular saint called Saint Faith, where the priest, it's a priest or the saint, is carrying the top of his own head in his hands. So when you have that kind of evidence, it's pretty compelling. And as I said, you'll get this from me all of the you wonder, I mean, Schroller must have been going through these 15 years with sort of a revelation a day, because some of the things that he figured out, I mean, as a scholar myself, that how these things occur, we'll get lots of this as we go along. And really, as I said, it's...
On the way out, I have to show you something. Just go for a second and come back. That's the 8 to 9 room. Yalla?
Or the other one.
Listen up.
Yeah, Clay?
Okay.
Are you the last? Okay. During lunch today, a few of you asked me how old is this temple. It was really hard to answer. There is never a temple that is exactly what we told you. I mean, Amenhotep III, 1400 and 1290 BC, Ramses. Temples are built over and over and over and over, all the temples. Usually the temple represents organic things. So on top you see the rope that holds the reeds, and then they do like this, you know, fall like this on top, yes? That's always the shape of the wall on top in the building, yeah?
The corniche.
Corniche. So why is there a corniche here?
Because there's a temple underneath.
Right.
Okay, that's my answer for today's lunch question.
I thought it was a good place to sit.
No, not necessarily. That one's upside down.
No.
Here's
it's
down.
Imagine that's the base of the temple and yet it's
no,
upside
it's
down.
It hadn't been rebuilt.
Yeah. That's a good look. Yes.
Yeah, so they'll probably dug down and probably find.
Thank you.
No one's thought of excavating?
Watch your step. We're going out right away.
It's a high level.